and censor speech, but that's what California has come to. My name is Karen England. I'm the executive director of Capital Resource Institute. We are one of the co-sponsors of this rally, helping to lead the way to fight this bill. I'm thankful for all the speakers before us. As you see, many lives have been changed, and if AB 2943 was enacted, it would prohibit these people from truly being able to change their lives. So the first thing I want to do is some housekeeping. We have restrooms in the back, tables with signs, and different co-sponsors' information over there. If you want to know who's been battling this bill, you can go over there. But I'm going to introduce our first speaker. He's incredibly bold. He's been fighting and fighting battles for a long time. He's going to open us in prayer and then say some words, and that is Pastor Jack Hibbs of Calvary Chapel, Chino Hills.
If you think about what we're being asked to consider as pastors and ministers, which is obviously the direction I'm coming from, we're being asked to take what the Word of God promises, that God changes. The Bible tells us, and it gives the list. Paul speaks to the Corinthians, a culture that was completely lost, a culture that was completely given over to whatever it wanted to do. And Paul goes down that list and he mentions all kinds of self-atrocities, that would be sins against self. And in listing all those things, he mentions these horrific things. He lists everybody, either in their actions or in their thoughts. He mentions, for example, in there, read it later if you'd like, homosexuality, among adultery and everything else. And then he says, and such were some of you. Listen, who are you today? Who are you today? You may not find yourself in a list of things that God disapproves of, but let me tell you something regarding that particular portion of Scripture. We've all sinned, the Bible says, and come short of the glory of God. We need the love of God. We need forgiveness. Every one of us live off the hope of being forgiven or forgiving another, correct? It's how we live as humans. And the Bible says we've been created in the image of God. God loves us. And listen, the LGBTQ community needs to know the love of God. Why would their hope be taken from them? Think of it. We have elected officials that want to take their will and impose it upon God's word, and for that matter, even the human heart. The human heart longs for change. So much of what you and I do every day is with the hope that something will be better. And that community that struggles with these temptations and sins, they need hope. They're not being bound, as our legislators would have them to believe, that they can never come out of a lifestyle that they now wake up to not wanting. Our legislators are condemning them to a pathway of life without change, without hope, and of all things. This particular ruling government says we're all about choice, all about choice, we're all about choice, and this AB 2943 takes choice right out of their hands. It takes the choice. If they were to come to my office and ask for help, and friends, they do. People searching and questioning their gender or their sexual activity, they'll come to a pastor and they'll say, I'd like to meet, I'd like to talk, I'm not happy, I'm thinking these thoughts, and I want hope. This bill, if passed, would render me unable to help them. I ought to be able to reach out to them and say, listen, I'm going to bring to you not my word, but the redemptive, loving word of God. And this is wrong. It's wrong in America, it's wrong in the world, it's wrong to the human culture. And let me end by saying this. The fact of the matter is, I believe as a pastor, it's not the municipality, it's not the government that is behind us. We're actually talking about legislation that would outlaw the Holy Spirit's ability to tell someone that they need love and hope and forgiveness and a brand new life. And frankly, no matter how this law goes, it's time for us as pastors and as Christians to obey the law of God, which is the law of love. And I don't know any pastor. If we lose this fight for freedom, if we lose this fight for freedom, and the nation is watching today what happens here. If we lose this fight for freedom, understand this, there's not a pastor I know that's going to obey this law. There's just no way. We need to stand because God's truth will always prevail. And for those of you who are Christians, let's remember this. Sometimes we lose battles, but the Bible's very clear. In the end, we win the war. And God fights with love. God saves with love. And it's all about the saving grace and love of Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right, you're hanging with us in the heat. Our next speaker, I use the word courageous, a very courageous man who has been standing in an arena where not always Christians will stand. He shows courage and leadership, and we should all be thankful and be praying for him as he's shaping the hearts and minds of young kids throughout the state. And that would be the president of William Jessup University, Dr. John Johnson.
Well, thank you, thank you. I want to thank you for coming to Sacramento today. Many of you have traveled long miles, you've enduring the heat, and I want to thank you. Your presence here means more than you know. Not only have you brought grace and kindness to the capital of our state, but you're helping to shift the atmosphere here, and I want to personally thank you for that. You know, I've been thinking about this day and about our present hour as a defining moment. Often when people think about defining moments, they think of Pearl Harbor, the assassination of President Kennedy, the Challenger explosion, 9/11, or some other date like or event like that. In my lifetime, defining moments often tend to mean things in our society that are powerful but negative. However, when I think of U.S. history, I think of what were far more positive defining moments that were also redemptive. I think of the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, the end of the Civil War, the victorious conclusion of World War II, and more recently, the Warriors winning the NBA championship again. The Kings are going to have their chance in years to come. Come on. Woo! But I think of today as a defining moment in our rally here. Often people think of rallies like this as oppositional and full of hatred. But I believe this rally is exactly opposite of that. This is a rally of people who are positive about what we are for. And let me just list several things. We're positively for the belief that there is a God of the universe, whom, by the way, our founders said that our constitutional rights were received from. We're positively for the belief that God loves all his children and that all of us are made in his image. We're positively for the belief that no matter what we have done in life, our God loves us and longs to bring us to forgiveness through the sacrificial gift of Jesus Christ on the cross. And we're positively for the belief that change is possible with the power of the Holy Spirit. And finally, we're positively for the belief that government should facilitate individual liberties and protect religious freedom. AB 2943, as currently written, and I'm praying that it will be changed. AB 2943, as currently written, prevents people who earnestly seek to experience change to receive the help that they desire, and therefore we are opposed to it. Many people say that the defining moment of life is when they decide their own identity. But I believe that Scripture is clear that life's most defining moment is when we come to a humble and surrendered relationship to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That is life's most defining moment. I want to thank you for being full of grace and truth. I want to thank you for being full of grace and truth, for modeling redemptive love to all people, and making this rally a defining moment in the history of the state of California by your presence and by your heartbeat here today. God bless you, and God bless the United States and California.
So that's William Jessup University. If any of you want to look it up and send your students there, he's the president. A shout out, William Jessup. A couple more housekeeping things, then we're going to move on to speakers. We have signs that say, respect our faith. We believe that you will be able to take these into the Capitol and hold them in the committee hearings. We'd also like to encourage you to stop by legislative offices and ask them to put them on their door to show that they stand for religious freedom. They've got all sorts of signs on their door, so please make sure you get one of these and that you go ask legislators to stand with those of us who are out here in the heat, standing for religious freedom. So our next speakers, if you were here earlier, you heard, and it's Ken Williams and Elizabeth Wanning. They're with Equipped to Love in Reading, and it's a ministry that you'll hear a lot about, and I believe they're bringing some additional speakers up with them. Elizabeth, Ken. You can clap for them. Raise the roof.
Well, is it afternoon or morning? I'm not sure. It's about to be hot, though. That I know. Thank you for being here today. My very first sexual desires were for males. I didn't have any sexual desires for females. And that was a very distressing internal conflict I was experiencing. This was the 1980s, and certainly it was a different culture than it is now. The only comment I had ever heard about homosexuality was that it was awful, right? That these people are terrible people, something about how God hates them, that was all I had ever heard. And so when you find yourself, because that is what happens, right? We find ourselves with our sexual desires. We don't plan them. We find ourselves. And when I discovered, wait a minute, I am not like the other boys. I don't seem to have any camaraderie with them. I'm being sexually attracted to them, and I'm not attracted to girls. That was a very frightening realization for me. All of the lights came on for me when I was watching a movie one night. It was about a 15-year-old boy, and I was 15 at the time. And he had discovered that he had same-sex attraction. He went to his family. His family took him to the psychologist. And mind you, his life was playing out on TV exactly like my life was playing out. I mean, the parallels were numerous. I was being mocked at school. I was being called gay or homo or faggot, yelled out at me as I walked home from school every day. So I'm watching him live my life. And he goes to see a counselor. The counselor tries to change, you know, help him change his sexual identity. No change happened for him. And the counselor says to his family and to him, you know, this is just how you were made, and there's no change possible for you. That was devastating for me. Now, there are people out there that believe that that is the case, and this is America. They are free to believe whatever they want to believe. They're free to pursue whatever choices they want to pursue in life or live out whatever identity they want. Well, at least right now they are. If this bill passes, they won't be. We won't be free anymore. But for me, it was devastating because I had no desire to have sex with a male. That's just the only humans I was sexually attracted to. I wanted so badly for that not to be the case. I wanted to fall in love with a lady. I wanted to have my own children. So I wrestled through life for 2 more years, just trying to stay alive. I had no hope because I knew of not one person that had ever changed. Not one person that ever had any tolerance for anyone who claimed that they had some homosexual attraction. So, but I didn't want to kill myself because I thought my family would never get over it. But I was growing tired. So when I was 17, I went into the Christian bookstore with a ball cap on, snuck in there to see if I could find any resource at all that gave me encouragement, that would give me hope for change. There was not one. So I walked out of the Christian bookstore suicidal. I walked in with hope, I walked out suicidal. I melted down, I wrote 9 pages of absolute hate, vulgarity, pain, all this stuff that had been bottled up inside, because you do realize that more than half of the people who experience same-sex attraction, LGBTQ-type feelings, were sexually abused. Their desires came after that happened. That's not the case for everybody, so I'm not saying that. But for many of us, that is the case. And this bill, AB 2943, takes people who have been sexually abused, some of them, victims, and says, we are going to mandate what now your future looks like. We are going to take away from you, as the state of California, as governors over the state, as lawmakers, as people more powerful than me and you, we are going to take away one of your options for your future. You, having had some same-sex attraction, must now remain in that. You may not explore any other sexual path for yourself. We have decided you are not allowed to pursue whatever you'd like to pursue, so we are banning books in America. Has anyone read any history books? Well, I guess they weren't banned, and so you were able to read those. We're talking about banning the sale of books in America, in California, from a people group who's been marginalized and outcast and confused, sexually abused, physically abused, emotionally abused. And furthermore, we're not okay with you getting whatever counseling you'd like. We'll decide, as the state of California, what options you should have for counseling. We feel like you need to just go with these new sexual desires that you have after you experience some kind of abuse. You must have to go with those now. So you will not be allowed to pursue whatever type of counseling you want if they offer any suggestion that you might be able to change minimally or in a large amount. You will not have that right anymore to pay to get the help that you want. That is what AB 2943 is about. Ladies and gentlemen, my life is radically different than it was. I went from suicidal, depressed, hating myself to encountering a living God that had solutions for me, which I found through my faith community. I found truth that changed me through teachings that I paid for, books that I read. Books saved my life. Those books of hope. They are out there now, on the shelves now, today. They might not be January 1st, but they are on the bookshelves today. I found a counselor who I met with for every week for 5 years who kept me alive. He gave me hope. He told me, hey, you need to go and see that there are other people like you. He pointed me to a group of people who were coming out of homosexuality, and I met these awesome people who were just like me. They were out there, and some of them were further down the journey than me, and they had started dating someone of the opposite sex, and they were finding great fulfillment in life and feeling so proud of themselves for the change that they had experienced. Sex with a woman and am married to her because I fell in love with her. My life is not some experiment or some research project to try to prove, you know, assuming the future and seeing that today was going to happen and that this bill was going to come on the books, that I wanted to start pretending that I actually was sexually attracted to a woman and live with her the rest of my life. I married her 12 years ago because I fell in love with her. We have 4 children. We have a great sex life. I have issues, but homosexuality is not it. I have children, so I have issues. America is about we get to choose who we are, we get to pursue it wholeheartedly, and if we want help with that, we get to get it. Do not allow anyone to convince you that this bill is about people's freedom or protecting people. It may be that someone thought that they were trying to help people with this bill, but I'm telling you, it only is helping a minority to the detriment of a super minority. We exist. There are 30 of us who testified this morning of change, of coming out of homosexuality and finding fulfillment in leaving that lifestyle. Not everybody has that story, but in America, that should be our rights. God bless you.
I think I missed the clean water rally.
Thank you, Ken, and thank you for everything you've been doing, leading the way.